Hi, Ange. Obviously, starting on Rodrigo Bentancur, who was outstanding first 20-odd minutes against Villa. I thought he was running the show. Then obviously he's picked up that injury, and it looks a serious one. How much of it is it a blow for you because of how many players are out at the moment, but also him personally, who's had week after week having to come back from such a serious knee injury?
Yeah, look, I think, I guess the biggest sort of emotion you have is for him because... And I've only sort of been here, what, 6 months. But, even that 6 months, you see how hard they work to get back, particularly him. A lot of it's a fairly lonely journey because you do the rehab on your own and you've got to push yourself. But pretty much from the moment I arrived, I think the first day I bumped into him, he was just that determined to get back. And he had his own timelines in his head. And I think I said, he kept banging on my door about being involved. And I kind of held back because, obviously, with such a significant injury, you want to make sure they're ready. And he'd done everything right. Obviously, he had a good international break where he got back playing for his country and, like you say, started the game so well. So with all that context, you're just gutted for him because of, the person he is and what he's gone through. But, that's, unfortunately, that's what the challenges football sometimes throws up at you. And, he's still such a positive guy. I caught up with him yesterday and he's just, again, determined to crack on and get back as quickly as possible. And, can't wait to get him back in because you saw his quality.
Pep Guardiola's just said in his press conference, you make football a better place. And I know I had a bit of fun on Sky about saying you copy and Pep, but you do have very similar philosophies about the way you play football and the attacking philosophies. But do all the injuries and the amount of players you've got out this Sunday, does it really put a damper on such a big game and someone you're looking forward to coming up against?
No, not really, because, irrespective of kind of what team you got, it's always going to be a challenge playing against, City and any team that sort of Pep manages. And you love that, you relish that. That's the kind of arena you want to be in, measuring yourself against the very best. And, it'd be great if, things were a little bit smoother for us, but it is what it is. And I still think during this period, even last week, there were moments in the game where we played some fantastic football. And that's what we've just got to crack on. We've just got to get on with it. Ultimately, we can't take our eyes off what we're trying to achieve here. And, that for me is always paramount to everything I do, every decision I make, every sort of time we put a team out there. It's about us, becoming the team we want to become. And through that process, there's going to be some challenges, as there is now, some tough times. And you just got to stay really focused on what you're trying to achieve.
Something we're asking all managers today, what's been a big topic, is sin bins for dissent and tactical fouls. A yellow card potentially in 10 minutes in the sin bin. It's working in some lower levels of football and it's working in other sports right at the very top. Just want to get your view on it.
Yeah, bin it, mate. Just bin the whole idea. Just forget about it. I don't understand why, and again, I think I've already said where I stand on this kind of stuff, but I don't know why they keep interjecting themselves into the game. There's not that much wrong in the game, but again, I guess once they throw an idea like that out, it usually means they've already sort of tested the waters and will probably be inevitable at one stage. I don't think there's a need for it. I think you're seeing a lot more dissent in the game these days because you've got more people to dissent to. In the past, it was just the referee. Now you can dissent to the fourth official. You can dissent to the VAR. You can dissent to the head of the referees. It used to be simpler. So the authority was with the referee, and he could handle it himself. So, but as I said, I just don't think we need to mess with the game too much. But it is what it is.
Good luck Sunday.
Thank you,
shall we?
Hi, Ange. Can you just confirm how long Rodrigo is set to be out for?
Look, not exact time frames, but significant time. So I guess similar type of injury. Still getting some information, but it'll be well into sort of early next year, a couple of months at least.
Obviously, he's just gone through a big recovery process from the ACL injury. You mentioned the lonely journey that players go on when they have to come back from an injury like that. How will you look to try and help him, particularly from a mental point of view, to go through yet another recovery process?
Yeah, look, it's not just me. I think, it's about the whole club. I mean, he spends a lot of time, obviously, with the medical team and then the sports science staff, and they've been really good with him. It starts with the player himself. Like I said, talking to him yesterday. He's such a positive guy, and you know, if it was me, I'd be a hell of a lot grumpier around the place. But you know, he's got a really positive outlook. He knows that, you know, he's been through a tough time, and he's got to go through another, you know, shorter tough time. But he also knows that, you know, and he felt it himself when he was out there, that he hasn't lost anything as a footballer, and that's the important thing, you know. And I think that's given him the incentive to get back as quickly as possible, and again make an impact for us.
And in terms of City, last weekend Liverpool ended their winning run at the Etihad Stadium. We saw Leipzig score two goals against them in midweek as well. They've drawn their last two Premier League games as well. So from looking at those matches, where do you feel your Spurs side can hurt them on Sunday?
Yeah, I wouldn't read too much into that. They're still a decent side. They're a very good football side. Like I said, it's a great test for us, a great test for where we're at as a group, as a team, as a sort of, you know, project of trying to become a team that plays the game a certain way. No greater measure than playing against the best, and that's what we'll have. We'll have a strong test you know, at the Etihad, and we're looking forward to it. I think the players are looking forward to it. I'm certainly looking forward to it, and they're the kind of things that you don't want to shy away from, because they'll give you a great sort of barometer as to where you're at. Not so much just in terms of the result or even the performance, but as much about your mindset of the kind of team you want to be.
Okay, thanks, Ange.
No, just microphone behind you.
Hiya. You said before your main goal is for the team to become the team you want them to be, and obviously we've seen your philosophy thus far this season. Is that why you'd say to people ahead of going to Man City with a weakened team, I'm not going to change my philosophy, I want to carry on playing this way, and if we don't get a result, so be it?
No, I'm not dismissing. I mean, I want us to get a result. And the reason we're going to play the way we are is because that's the way I think is the best way for us to get the result. But at the same time, you know, we have, you know, a plan in place to sort of become a certain kind of football team and try and bring success to this football club. And it's not an easy road, and you're going to get challenged a long way. And your resolve only gets challenged in tough times. It doesn't get challenged when things are going well. It's kind of easy just to roll along with it. But invariably there's tough times, and we're going through one right now. And we've just got to stay strong in terms of, you know, who we want to be, and make sure that we don't sort of lose focus of what the end game is, because that's why most teams and most organisations, I think, at some point falter, is because in the tough times when the resolve gets tested, we're found wanting.
The squad is being tested right now with injury and suspension. Has that given you even more of a desire to, in January, look to strengthen the squad?
No more desire. I mean, like I said, we've had one transfer window, so I don't think anyone would have said that we were going to get everything we needed to get done in one transfer window. So we had a really positive window in terms of, you know, the players we brought in have all made an impact. You know, we've obviously got a couple who are injured at the moment, but there's no denying all the players we brought in have made a massive impact to the football club. So that was always stage one. And as I said, I think last week, that, you know, sometimes circumstances mean you get to test things that otherwise you may not have had to if we hadn't had all the injuries. So we're giving other players an opportunity to see where they fit in, you know, give them the opportunity to sort of be part of what we're trying to build here. And, you know, that's the sort of point we're in right now.
And finally, I mean, you can't undo technology. I don't think we're ever going to get rid of VAR now that we have it. You clearly are against the idea of bringing a SIM bin. But should IFAB be speaking to top-level managers like yourself, or rather than just putting ideas out there that'll look at corners and throw-ins and sin bins and then impose them on you, and then you have to answer questions from idiots like me every week about technology?
Don't talk about yourself like that, mate. Yeah. You're asking some really intelligent questions, so there's nothing wrong with that. No, look, I'd be very surprised if IFAB are putting this out without talking to football people. I'd be very surprised if they're doing that. But it's obviously, you'll get varying opinions, and you know, if they were to ask me, I'd be pretty clear as I have been about my thoughts on it. But, you know, I'm sure that IFAB are doing that and probably finding that my opinion is in the minority, because that's the only reason I can assume that they're going ahead with these things.
Hi, Ange. If Pat Matasar isn't available again, I think it's potentially 11.
He's not available.
He's not available. So that's 11 unavailable first team players. I know you've had lots of challenges over your career. Have you ever had this amount of players out in one?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't thought a lot about it, but fair to say, I don't think so. Not in such a sort of high volume for such a sort of short space of time. You know, over the course of a season, yes. You know, like most managers, you go through sort of spells where you're missing players, but to have this much in such a small space of time is probably the first time I've sort of experienced something like that. And you know, that's what you love about football. No matter how old you are, how long you've been around, there's always something new you got to deal with. And if I'm in a situation again where I've got 11 absences, this experience will make me better for it, mate.
And on January again, but just a bit more specifically, obviously you're not going to have Bentancur, Maddison, Bissouma and Sarr as well, the AFCON as well.
Sonny.
And Sonny as well, but I mean mainly in midfield. Okay. Is that going to make you have to dip into the market in that position, or is that too short term?
Well, it depends. Like we're not sort of ruling anything because, again, what you've just sort of outlined there is the best case scenario, that is if everyone else is here stays fit, so which is hasn't been the case so far. So we may be forced to, you know, we may have no choice on it. But again, we're not going into it sort of January. We've got some sort of specific ideas about what we're going to try and do for sure. But you know, at the same time, you know, depending on how things go between now and then and how the sort of recovery of guys is, you know, we may need to make a different kind of decision, but all that work's been done so that we're ready, you know, either way.
And just last one from me. After the game the other day, you mentioned about the height in defence. Obviously, that was one of the struggles they did have. So for City, obviously, Haaland and his aerial ability, is this a scenario we're going to have to bring Eric Dier back in, or is it just one of the options?
No, you know, it's not, you know, it's, I mean, that was one aspect I thought we struggled with last week in terms of, mainly around set pieces, or, you know, to be fair, Villa are very good at them. But, no, you know, again, we overall, I thought our defending was actually quite good. We were disappointed with the second goal. I thought even more so than the first goal. I thought, you know, not just the back four, but defensively, we were really passive in that sort of 5-10 minute spell, which we paid a price for. So that was more of a collective thing. So, mate, no, that. They haven't grown at all. They're all the same height as last week. Tried to feed them some different stuff, but we'll go in with that.
Ange, just on VAR, I know you're not a fan of the system, but if it's here to stay, in your experience, is the one thing or some suggestion you'd make to improve the current processes?
Look, I think if they stuck to why they brought it in initially, I think less people have an issue with it. So if I hear one more person say that it doesn't re-referee a game, I'll explode, mate, because that's exactly what it's doing. It was brought in for clear and obvious errors, right? Clear and obvious error for me would be if all of us in this room saw something and go, that's definitely wrong. I think at the moment it's going with, well, you know what, the majority in this room say it's wrong. So just leave it for what it was there for. You know, if you've got to look at something from seven different angles, slow it down to the minute, that's not a clear and obvious error. That's re-refereeing the game. Because the referee has seen it. He said there's nothing wrong with it. And then you're showing him seven different angles and slowing it down. That's not a clear and obvious error. So like I said, if I could show you a decision here and all of you say straight away, that's handball. All of you say that's a bad tackle. Then I go, well, that's a clear and obvious error. But if you go, I'm not sure. Well, let me show you this angle. Let me slow it down for you a little bit. Let me just show you what happened before. I just think that's where we've gone wrong with it, you know. And you know, it's why I think the goal line technology was so seamless. It's black and white. It's done. You know, it's over the line. It's not over the line. Move on with it.
Can I just ask on Ashley Phillips as well? Is he close to things at the moment?
That A's out long term as well, mate. He won't be sort of at least sort of new year for him as well.
James.
Hi, Ange. It's just about Erling Haaland. Is he the most complete centre forward that you've ever seen at that age? He's 23. And given what a clinical finisher he is the key to stopping him, stopping the supply into him, because by the time he gets the ball, it's sort of too late.
Yeah, no, it's always hard to make comparisons because, I mean, I come from generations where a lot of young strikers were pretty decent when they first started. But he's, you know, his movement, his, like I said, his finishing, but more his real sort of focus on scoring goals is quite extraordinary, because you'll see other strikers who you know, are focused on scoring goals, but he has a real strong mindset of being in that position. You see when he misses a chance, I reckon within a millisecond he's moved on, you know, and looking for the next one. And, yeah, he's, like I said, it's frightening at his age, what the amount of goals he could score. But, yeah, the key is, I guess, you know, can we, as a group, sort of handle, you know, what attacking threat, you know, invariably a team like Man City have, and they come from different avenues, and can we, like I said, minimise the amount of times they get the ball to him, minimise what areas they get the ball to him. But, you know, they can hurt you in many ways. You know, even if Erling doesn't score, they've got plenty of goal threat in there. So for us, it's going to be a great test to kind of try and minimise all those threats, and more importantly, be a threat ourselves, because otherwise, if we're not a threat ourselves, then, you know, you can sort of hold the damn wall for as long as you possibly can, but eventually they'll break through it.
And given the defensive injuries you've got, I mean, can you combat him in the way that you want to, or are you going to have to kind of improvise this weekend?
No, I think, look, irrespective of kind of the players we've got available, it would still be a collective approach, I think, is the best way, you know, like I said, because if you put too much on trying to shut him down, then, you know, there'll be a Phil Foden or Silva or Alvarez, or I could go through the whole team, mate, to be honest, and you know, they're still going to hurt you. So it has to be a collective approach, irrespective of kind of the personnel we have.
Okay, George from the BBC, and then George from PA, please.
Angelo, sorry, I know you've got so many injuries, but are you going to go a little bit more defensive on Sunday, and like that you're playing the Champions, you've got such a good home record, or are you going to carry on taking it to Man City like you've done for most of the season, and like you did to Villa on Sunday?
If you had to take a punt, what do you reckon I'd say? Just a wild guess out of it. I don't want to be flippant about it, and I get the question, but I don't do what I do because of, yeah, I've said before, trying to prove a point. It's just, yeah, you look at the top teams and there's one sort of common trait amongst them. They've all got a plan. They invest in that plan and they stick to it, yeah? They don't shy away from that the first difficulty. You know, you look at whether it's City or Arsenal or Liverpool, all the teams that have dominated in recent years, they've got a plan, they stick to it, yeah? And you have to, because your resolve doesn't get, like I said, whatever you believe in, whatever you really strongly believe in, you as a person, only gets tested in the toughest of times. It doesn't get tested when things are going well. And for me, like, these are the important times, because this will show what kind of football team we want to be. You can sort of shy away from, you know what, we've got injuries, we're playing Man City away, and, you know, but you're either going to be a club that tries to knock off the big clubs, or you're a big club. You're one or the other. You know, my hope and my ambition for this club is to make it a big club. And to do that, you have to be successful. You have to win things. To win things, you've got to have a plan. You've got to stick to it. You've got to believe in it. And you've got to be prepared that during the tough times, when you get scrutinised, and invariably, you know, people will ask questions, which is fair enough, because that's what I think needs to happen. Again, it's the only way you can really test yourself. No good if everyone keeps telling you you're brilliant. That's not a good way to live your life, you know. The best way to keep challenging yourself is when people challenge you, and so you've got to be prepared for that, and you've got to take that, and you've got to show, you know, some backbone through that time. That's what I believe, right? So that's my methodology. So I'm not going there to show people, oh, you know, you watch me, I'm just going to take it. It's because I think that's the way forward for us.
It could be an absolutely brilliant game then on Sunday.
I hope so, yeah. I mean, ultimately that's what we want, isn't it? I know we were obviously disappointed with last week, but it was still a cracking game. You know, we could have scored 5 or 6 on any other day. I'd much rather take that from us than, like I said, the game before against Wolves, I just, you know, even if I was a supporter, I'd be walking away going, you know, well, yeah, not a great game of football. So it's still part of it for me anyway, you know, and it's why I relish these kind of games, you know, because you go there, you test yourself. Okay, you may not come out on top, but you're going to have a crack at it for sure. Thanks, mate.
George, to finish us off in the broadcast section, please.
Hi, Ange. You will have Bissouma back this weekend. And he had such a strong start to the season, but it's almost felt like maybe since the Luton game, he's not quite hit those levels. Have you sort of sensed any change in him since that?
No, I think it was just more the disruption. He obviously, you know, he got the red card and then he got suspended. So, you know, he hasn't really had a good sort of run at it since then. But yeah, really pleased to get Biss back. He's such an important part of sort of our setup with the way he plays in that role. And, you know, would love to see him and Rodrigo in there. And I had all these plans and they've just gone out the window. Anyway, that's me speaking out loud, sorry. But it's good to get Biss back and, hopefully now. Look, if you look at sort of the first third of the season's gone and you look at it and from a results perspective, I reckon we're still on the positive side of the ledger from the first 13 games. Performance-wise, I still think we're on the positive side of the ledger, even though we've had some disappointments. But an area we needed to improve is discipline. He's part of that. You know, I think that's let us down this first half of the year in terms of just, not just in terms of cards, but in terms of just being really focused in our approach. And these are things we need to learn as a team. And I'm sure Biss probably feels that himself. He's probably a bit frustrated with kind of the fact that he had such a great start, now it's been disrupted. But yeah, like I said, great to get him back. And particularly against a team like City, he's going to be very important for us.
Yeah, just finally for me, do you think maybe that fifth yellow card hanging over him, knowing that if he got one more, he's going to get a suspension, has maybe subconsciously affected him, and hopefully now he can have a bit more freedom?
Yeah, potentially. But again, it's kind of a lesson for him, for us as a group, that these kind of things, you know, if you want things to sort of run a bit more smoothly, you've got to be really disciplined in your approach and sort of really focused in what you do. So hopefully he comes out of that, like I said, knowing that, you know, for him to be to maintain becoming a real important part of our team, he needs to have that discipline, focus, not just him, like I said, the whole group. I think that's an area where, if you look, like I said, the first 13 games has really cost us.